congratulations to Gordon and the team for, I think, this really important conference. I think Kim Beazley has indeed set the scene with the contemporary strategic centrality, really, of the conversation that we're going to be having here here today. What I'm going to do in a pretty short time frame is to take you on a quick tour of the idea of the Indo-Pacific and why it matters. Why, really, this is not just about looking at old maps and thinking in an academic way about our place in the world, but why the changing strategic geography that Australia finds itself in, and indeed that Western Australia particularly finds itself in, is of globally pivotal significance. So, look, I'll just first remind us that this idea of the Indo-Pacific is not new. And if you don't believe me, then just take a glance at this map from the first decent atlas in 1571 by the Dutch mapmaker Ortelius, which captures in a very contemporary way really the maritime Asia that is so important to the world today. East Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, North America, all in the one strategic system. And there's even, if you look very neatly in the bottom centre there, there's a little place called Australis, which intriguingly has the word beach attached to it on the map. So maybe they knew something back then that we didn't. But quite seriously, we're returning to, in many ways, I think, the historical reflection of our place in the region, the Indo-Pacific, as it's now called. And if you, again, want some evidence of that, it's fascinating to juxtapose the image you've just seen with this map, which, of course, many of you will recognise from the Defence White Paper in 2013. And I note that Stephen Smith is here, and, of course, it was as Defence Minister that Stephen Smith really stewarded this really important shift in Australia's strategic direction, the first formal document of any country in the world to formally recognise its region as the Indo-Pacific. And this wasn't just semantics. This is a recognition of the deep economic and geoeconomic connections in our region, the sea lanes, the energy flows, the container traffic, container shipping, and of course the strategic connections that come with that, that come with, in many ways, the return of major Asian powers, particularly China, but also India, and others as prominent and very central trading, investment and infrastructure players in the world. And this, of course, puts Australia, whether we like it or not, much closer to the centre of the action. So what is the Indo-Pacific? It's a place and an idea. And as an idea and a place, it has these characteristics that I think inform policy, inform strategy, inform the decisions that governments need to make about managing this much more contested strategic future that we face. And a few of those characteristics: this is definitively a maritime region. It will remain a maritime region until that day comes when it becomes cheaper to move goods by land than by sea, and I don't see that coming anytime soon. It's a region that's based on connectivity with economic origins, but with strategic implications. And you'll see in a moment how major powers, particularly China, but not only China, ascending the flag to follow trade, not unlike the early colonial empires. You're seeing a security and a military footprint following the so-called Belt and Road in Australia's maritime backyard, among other places. It's a shared space. It's a region of many players. It's made for multipolarity. And that's good news for Australia in many ways, because this is partly a concept that we can use to manage both Chinese disruption, the power and assertiveness that has come with the rise of China, and the unpredictability and, I have to say, the dysfunction that we're seeing in aspects of American policy making at the moment. This is about embedding those powers, diluting them in a region of many players, where most of the players are broadly like-minded with Australia. It's the global centre of gravity. It's the new high road of geoeconomics, of trade, of investment, of infrastructure. And again, the good news, but this is not reason for complacency, it's too big to dominate. The problem is we don't want great powers to learn that the hard way, and hence the emphasis on readiness and deterrence that Kim Beazley just pointed out. It's also, I think, a metaphor for cooperation, for collective action. I'll update this photograph soon after the next the next summit, of course. But the point is, it's not only about big regional institutions like the misnamed East Asia Summit that is really an Indo-Pacific summit, but it's about this new geography really legitimising new forms of cooperation, whether it's with Australia and India, Japan, Indonesia, France, a whole range of powers that probably haven't been working closely enough together. The geography opens the way to their cooperation. Last of all, it's our place in the world, and I think this applies not least, in fact, probably more so to the north and the western coast of Australia. This map from 1848 really captured it. The Scottish-Australian explorer Thomas Mitchell already had something like the Indo-Pacific in mind in his journals in 1848. So this is not new for Australia. It's a return to, I think, an enduring past. As I said, there's an economic component to all of this. We've heard of the so-called Belt and Road, or One Belt, One Road, the big Chinese geoeconomic strategy. But what's important about the Indo-Pacific is that it's a place of many belts and many roads. This is a place where many nations and private sector actors as well are beginning to recognise that great need for infrastructure and connectivity. And any kind of sustainable future in this region is going to require cooperation and multiple players, not an exclusive one nation, you know, China-centric, for example, Belt and Road approach. The economic dimension has an acute, angle to it for Australia, of course, in terms of energy security. And I don't need to tell this audience about the vulnerability of Australia's seaborne energy supplies, Australia's oil. And of course, that further heightens the need for a strong maritime strategy to protect these absolutely core interests at the heart of our prosperity. It's also about trade in a broader sense, and I think if you look at these projections from Lloyd's of London of anticipated seaborne trade in the year 2030, the Indo-Pacific is well and truly the global centre of gravity. Those sea lanes to our north and to our northwest are going to be absolutely central economically, but militarily as well. And although for the time being the leadership in Beijing doesn't particularly like the term the Indo-Pacific, it's striking that when China even projects what kind of military strategy it's looking for in the region, it is quite happy to show off a battle command centre that has India and the Indian Ocean absolutely at the centre. In other words, China is recognising that as its interests expand across the Indian Ocean, the Belt and Road into South Asia, Africa, the Middle East, so too must its military capabilities. China has categorically turned to the sea as a major maritime power, and that brings risks. It brings some advantages for China, but also some very significant challenges that, again, the right mix of diplomacy and deterrence will help the rest of us to manage and moderate. Make no mistake, the point that the Governor made a moment ago about the changing external environment, it doesn't matter in a sense of your own opinion or your own view as to the rightness or wrongness of particular policies at the moment, we are entering a phase where great power military competition is real and where the possibility of this escalating cannot be ruled out. And there were academics only a decade ago who were insisting great power military competition, indeed war, is obsolete. We can't say that anymore. So the challenge for us, really for Australia as a key middle player in the Indo-Pacific, is to work with others to keep this five-point spectrum no further than where it is at the moment, a phase of competition drifting into confrontation, but to try to bring it back to competition, coexistence, perhaps eventually security, cooperation. And again, that will require everything but complacency. As I've said already, China has turned, I think, definitively to the sea. 2 years ago, 3 years ago now, Xi Jinping made it clear that the land no longer outweighs the sea in China's military modernisation, the rapid development of the Chinese Navy and its activity in the Indian Ocean. And for those of you who aren't aware, these fairly much annual now surface warfare exercises are conducted not far from Australia's Indian Ocean territories. This is China demonstrating its ability to project force and to protect its energy vulnerabilities in the Indian Ocean. And you can imagine the anxiety this is causing in a number of regional powers. It's not only about China. India is rising as an Indo-Pacific power, and although it has its limitations, it's also showing great prospects as a security partner for Australia. And it's wonderful to see Shiv Shankar Menon here today for an Indian perspective. Japan is another of the major powers in the Indo-Pacific whose interests and activities we cannot underestimate. Indeed, it's fair to say that Prime Minister Abe has been the most active and strategic of any leaders in the region in recent years in pursuing an Indo-Pacific form of diplomacy, in pursuing new creative arrangements, whether it's the quadrilateral dialogue, trilateral relations with Australia and Japan, or with Australia and India, or the United States and India, or interestingly, a much tighter relationship with India. And you may have seen the double hug that Abe got from Modi on his visit to Japan last weekend. So we can't rule Japan out of this strategic game. And then, of course, the United States. Whatever its current problems, its dysfunction, its distraction, the US remains the crucially powerful state globally, the leading global military power with enormous capability to influence the and shape the strategic dynamics of the Indo-Pacific. So it's really about what sort of partnership we're looking for, what sort of alliance we're looking for with the United States, and the extent to which other partners and allies can contribute to a shared effort that should be part of the conversation here today. And there are others, including European powers, coming back to the Indo-Pacific. And so Australia plays a role, really as quite a central hub in all of this this change, this churn. We have the relationships, we have the credibility and the capability to really help shape this regional order in ways that suit our interests. And that's why we really need to continue to get our act together. Now, I'll leave this for you to, digest at your leisure, but there's a lot more material I'd be happy to share with you on another occasion about how, in fact, the Indo-Pacific reflects an older history of Asia, right through to the connections of Hindu and Buddhist civilization into Southeast Asia and East Asia, China's forays into the Indian Ocean in the 1400s, the spread of Islam to Southeast Asia, across the Indian Ocean, and the very Indo-Pacific character of those colonial connections that in many ways we're beginning to see, return in a more benign way to the region. The role that Indo-Pacific powers, the role that, for example, Indian forces within the British Empire played in the Pacific War, in bringing stability and peace to Asia, to the Indo-Pacific, has often been underestimated. So in a sense, this Asia-Pacific era that is now ending was a kind of interlude following the Second World War, when China and India were temporarily turned inwards and when the global focus was on the Atlantic and Europe. But really, we're returning to this Indo-Pacific centre of gravity. And there's a whole lot of key dates where we can see these turning points. We can see, beginning with China becoming a net importer of oil in 1993, right through to a whole range of strategic decisions, deployments, summits, and so forth, that this Indo-Pacific era we're entering was almost an inevitability, was almost the logical development of the Asia-Pacific concept. And because of all of that, we're really back to a phase now where Australia, like it or not, is really at the centre of regional and global strategic gravity. The decisions that we make in terms of our own capabilities, our own partnerships, are going to resonate far beyond Australia. I'll conclude just with a couple of, key thoughts on what Australia will need in an Indo-Pacific strategy. And bear in mind, there's now a lot of activity going on in foreign affairs and defence and other parts of government in framing what an Indo-Pacific strategy would look like to turn these ideas into action. It's certainly a strategy that is based on that multipolarity about bringing in many players. It's based on mutual respect. In other words, whether you call it a rules-based order or not, it's about ensuring that the rights of small and middle powers and their sovereignty are respected. And it's about building cooperation in a very hard-headed way, having capabilities that demonstrate that Australia is an effective partner in security cooperation, whether that's for humanitarian activity, disaster relief, or whether it's for deterrence. Because it's going to be that balance of diplomacy and deterrence that determines whether this next phase of the Indo-Pacific story is one of cooperation, of coexistence, or of confrontation, or indeed of conflict. I'll leave it there, and I wish you well with deliberations today. Thank you.